Good morning, everybody. This is Pastor Tom welcoming you to another study in the Word. Today we're going to talk about ongoing deliverance messages that I'm doing. I'm doing number 12. I hope that's right. It's been a while since I've did some of these, so I thought it'd be good if I went back and did some. And today I'd like to talk on a subject that I think will be beneficial to you. 2 Timothy chapter 2, if you look at verse 1. Now therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. One of the reasons I'm doing these series of teachings is because I've been I've been around a long time, and I've seen a lot of real bad things amongst people who, quote-unquote, are in the deliverance ministry. Now, having now almost 40 years of experience, you learn some things, and I'm not mad at anybody. People make mistakes. I certainly had made mistakes, but over the years, I've learned some things that I think will help you, so I'm going to share those things today. I'm going to talk about dangerous and unscriptural things that a lot of deliverance people are involved in. And let me first say this, getting people delivered from evil spirits is not some kind of a Wild West shootout game we're playing. It's not something we should do without a little bit of training, especially one-on-one. That's what I'm talking about now. If I'm in a service somewhere and the anointing is flowing and some evil spirits manifest, I normally dislodge them very easily. And the gifts of the Spirit are in operation. That's always easy. But, when you're doing one-on-one ministry, especially if you happen to be one of these people that are doing it on Skype or Facebook Live or whatever, there's some things that you need to remember, because you're responsible for what you tell people, how you do it, deliverance, one-on-one, and so on. So we're going to talk about some of these things that I've seen over the years that you need to avoid. So we need to stay away from unscriptural, flaky, weird practices, especially those that are being taught in some places on social media about deliverance. Always remember this: it is important for you to always base everything that you do on the Word of God. And you remember this, in any deliverance session, no matter whether it be live in a church service or just live with somebody, or if you're doing it on Skype, you're trying to do these things, always remember, there are no hard and fast rules. A lot of people just like go down the same thing every time because somebody told them that this is the way you do it. Actually, the truth of the matter is we got to rely upon the Holy Ghost and nothing else. But always remember this: the Holy Ghost will never lead somebody outside of the Word of God, and the Holy Ghost will never lead somebody to practice or get involved in unscriptural and flaky things. So that's the first thing you need to know. If something seems really funny, strange, weird out there, normally the Holy Ghost is not in that and won't lead you to do that. However, you also have to leave room for some interesting things. Remember, Jesus did some things that people probably would have a hard time with today. Spitting on people's eyes, making mud and putting it in people's eyes. That's pretty strange. So there are at times where that can happen, but for the most part, we need to just watch out when things get too strange, or we don't have any scripture for them. Deliverance principles are very good, but we need to be led by the Holy Ghost in which principles we use, because every deliverance I've ever been involved in has always been a little bit different. And so what I try to do is know the principles from the Word of God about what to do in deliverance, then approach it and ask the Holy Spirit what He wants me to do. Some crazy things I've seen over the years that are still people do practice once in a while. You'll see something like this. One deliverance minister had a young girl come to her, about 12 years old, and he was an excellent person. But this girl was nervous and wanted to know what he was going to do in this deliverance session. Of course, he was accompanied by his parents. Children should always be accompanied by their parents before you ever try to do any kind of deliverance. You get yourself in a lot of trouble if you don't follow that rule. But also, this particular person had been to other ministry of deliverance before, this the little girl, and this parents had brought her to these other people. And so she seemed very upset, and she seemed nervous. And so he is asking her, she was asking what he was going to do, and he started talking to her and found out that the last time that they took this little girl to deliverance, the deliverance ministry did some things, and then when they brought her home, she was very upset. So her father, who was not there, the mother had taken her, the father who was not there, wondered what was going on. And she had bruises on her legs, she had bruises on her back and on her body. And what had happened was the deliverance ministry was taught or thought, where he got the idea, I don't know, because I can't find anything in scripture about something like this. But he said, he went on to say that certain demons indwell certain parts of the body. And I don't see any scripture for that. But there is, of course, it can be a spirit of blindness, but you know where that's at. It's got to be in the eyes, right? Or a spirit of deafness would be in the ears. But those are spirits that are pointed out, you know, because of what they do, the effect they have. But you don't have a whole lot more than that to go on. But so this guy was telling her that certain demons infect certain periods, parts of the body. And the way to get them out was to start pounding that area of the body with his hand until they came out. And so he pounded her back, pounded her legs, and she came back with these bruises. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, that's abusive. And if that would have been my little child and I would have found out about it, I think I would have went and abused that deliverance ministry a little bit. But that's just me. Maybe you have a different idea. You don't need to pound on people. You know, the less you have to do anything even relating to something like that, the less manifestations that you can have, the better. You know, sometimes you're going to have manifestations and there's not anything you're going to be able to do about that. Make them shut up and you know, the least the better. That's the way I pray. I don't pray for them to manifest with all kind of wild stuff. I pray them, I take authority over them for them not to. And if they start talking and carrying on, I make them shut up, because that's what Jesus did. Now, here's another one. One time a deliverance ministry was having difficulty getting a demon to come out. So he grabbed, they were using communion, which is a great thing to do in deliverance, but grabbed this person, pulled their head back, held their mouth open, and forced the communion wine or a grape juice or whatever they're using down the person's throat. That kind of thing's abusive. There has been records, not just a few, of people who are quote-unquote exercising demons. I hate that word, because that word is not, the only time it's used in scripture was relating to the Jewish exorcists who use magical spells to remove demons. I don't want to be involved in exorcisms. But you know, he was trying to cast it out. Communion's great, but you don't hold somebody's head and make them do things like that. That's abusive. There's been times where people have tied people up and left them for many hours as they prayed over them, and to the point to where they gave them no water for such a long period of time, they became dehydrated and died. You have to watch that kind of thing. Now, so these are things we need to watch out for. You don't tie people up. I know that sounds pretty funny. This is a true story. So a guy's ministering in church, right? I've had this happen many times. And all of a sudden, somebody in the back room falls out and they're manifesting a demon. It's very clear what it is. So the guy's wife goes back there to handle this, see what she can do for this particular individual in the service there while the service is still moving, going on. And when she gets back there, she found that this particular individual was covered with Bibles, because they had been taught in this church that the Word of God was powerful and sharp and will get people delivered. And so they believed that if they covered her in Bibles, that was going to somehow deliver her. Well, the Word of God, covering somebody with Bibles, is just another silly thing, like putting a cross on their head or sprinkling them with some kind of blessed holy water, which is ridiculous. There's no scripture for that in the New Testament that I can see. Or whatever else people do, you know, making crosses on their heads, you know, and all that kind of stuff that you see in the movies is nothing, it's ridiculous. The Word of God or the Bible is only powerful if it's coming out of our mouths or we're reading it and we're using it that way. So I thought that was kind of funny. But people do that. They'll put crosses on. I've seen them. They put the cross on the person's head. That means nothing. I've seen them take crucifixes with Jesus still on the crucifix and put it on their heads, thinking that that has power. And in the movies, of course, that's where they get that stuff from. But you don't get any of that in the scripture. So they make them sprinkle them with holy water, make them drink some kind of blessed water. That's not scriptural. There's nowhere in the New Testament I see where people drink any blessed water to get deliverance. Ridiculous. And another thing, too, that people do all the time is they seem to chant the blood over and over. The blood, the blood, the blood, the blood. Well, I understand where they're coming from, but the blood of Jesus Christ, that's not really the way we should approach that. We should talk about the blood and what it does. We should talk about, in the scriptures, what the blood has provided. Certainly the demons don't like that, and it's a very powerful tool. Pleading the blood of Jesus is fine, but chanting over and over the blood, blood, doesn't get anybody anywhere except dry mouth. And here's another one. This is really far-fetched and out there. I read about a couple that were ministering deliverance. And what they would do is they would swallow air and burp. And when asked what they were doing, they said that they were receiving the spirits as they were coming out of the person they were ministering to into them, and then they would burp them out. Now, I know that sounds far-fetched and weird, but that's the way some people think. Well, of course, that is crazy and dangerous. You don't invite evil spirits to come into you. You're safe, and if you're washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, you're ministering deliverance. You don't have to be concerned about that. But asking them to come into you, that's something that witches do. That's something that New Age people or satanic people would do. And so what happened to this couple is that this woman that was involved in doing this supposed deliverance ended up having a terrible, terrible tormenting situation with many, many demons that she ended up being tormented with. Now, so you need to watch that kind of stuff. Another thing that was popular back in the 1960s and early 70s was carrying barf bags. I know that sounds bad. And expecting everybody that you cast a demon out to barf or to throw up. When you tell people, this is how the demon's going to come out, or you're going to throw up every time the demon comes out, or you're going to cough every time the demon comes out, it's very unwise. And again, we don't have any scripture for that. Now, there was scriptures in the Bible where demons manifested coming out. One, we have them where they threw them on the ground. Jesus, one time with Jesus, threw it on the ground. Jesus said, come out and don't tear that individual. Remember that? And we do have that. Sometimes they do manifest. And I've seen some wild manifestations. But you don't tell them, well, this is the way the demon comes out. Just cast it out. If there's a manifestation, okay. If not, that's fine too. So you don't go by that. You go by getting the witness that it's gone from the Holy Spirit. And that's how you go about ministering deliverance. All right? Or the person will just tell you that thing left, you know. And so that's good. So always remember, we're relying on the Holy Spirit. One of the worst things you can ever do is pray for some type of manifestation. And I know some people who do that. They pray, devil, manifest yourself. In the name of Jesus, manifest yourself. And they'll start calling out the names of evil spirits. You spirit of gluttony, manifest yourself. Or you spirit of whatever, manifest yourself. Well, you got a person that is receiving deliverance. And when you start that kind of thing, what you can do is you can actually channel spirits, because that person is open and receptive to ministry. And if they're like that and they're already being spiritually tormented, you might get a manifestation. In other words, an evil spirit can come in there and start that, because you're actually calling on these, by name, these evil spirits. Now, there's nothing wrong with calling an evil spirit a name. If the Holy Spirit gives you the name of an evil spirit, you can do that. Sometimes that's the key to a deliverance. Jesus did that once. He says, what's your name? And I think the reason he did that is because the first time he said, come out, it didn't come out. And so he asked him what his name was. And if something's happening where you're praying for somebody and they're having some kind of manifestation and it's not coming out, you could say that, "What's your name?" And a lot of times when you do that, it exposes, seems to weaken them, and they will come out. I think that's why Jesus did that. But I don't do that unless that's totally necessary. But that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is going in there and just saying, you know, we're going to go, we're going to call these different demonic spirits. We're going to name them and call them to manifest. Now, there's nothing wrong with going through a list of demonic spirits and just saying, "In the name of Jesus, a spirit of this or that, if you're there, in the name of Jesus, come out of them." Well, you know, just like that. That's okay. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about calling on these evil spirits to come and manifest themselves. That's dangerous. There's a difference. I think you understand what I'm saying. At least I hope you do. One of the worst things you can do is not relying on the Holy Spirit, but relying on demonic spirits to get you information. Now, this is done all the time. People will try to talk to evil spirits to get information from them. And the Bible, in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 11, talks about people who talk to the dead, talks about talking to familiar spirits. It's literally in the Word of God is forbidden. And that kind of practice to get information and to consult with them, like Saul did, and get information from them, is what we're talking about right now, is unscriptural and very dangerous, yet it's done all the time. And when people teach deliverance, they'll teach you, some of them will teach you to do that. One of the worst things you can ever do is try to get information from a demon spirit. Why would you get information from a demon spirit when you have the Holy Spirit of God on the inside of you? If you need information in a deliverance about something, ask God, ask the Holy Spirit to help you, and He will help you and share with you what you need to know to take care of whatever situation you happen to find yourself in. But they'll ask him questions about every kind of thing. They'll ask him questions about Satan's world out there and, you know, what demons rule this part of the planet and that, you know, and they'll go on and on. And then they'll write this stuff down and they'll teach it and even put it in books. Listen, number one, why shouldn't we talk like that and converse with evil spirits? Which is, I think, probably the number one thing that people do wrong in deliverance is they get involved in that. And, you know, during the 1970s, when 60s and 70s, when there was a wave of deliverance, people started doing this type of thing, asking demons all kinds of questions, getting them to, you know, calling on them to manifest, like I was talking about. And people like Kenneth Hagin and Oral Roberts and T.L. Osborne, Lester Summerall, Derek Prince, and people who had legitimate ministries in these areas began to get people lined up at their door who got demons when they were in deliverance sessions. So we need to be listen to what I'm saying. You don't need information from evil spirits, okay? Get it from the Holy Ghost. Number one, the reason you don't do it is because demons are all liars. They're not going to tell you the truth. And by the way, there's a teaching that's going around that you can force demons to tell you the truth. You can't force a human being to tell you the truth. What makes you think you're going to force a demon to tell you the truth? They're liars. The Bible doesn't say, well, you can force demons. You have authority over demons to cast them out. You got authority over demons to make them go. But there's nowhere in the Bible where it says we have authority to make demons tell the truth. They can't. They're liars by nature. Jesus told them their father, Satan, is a father of lies, and those that have evil spirits, when evil spirits are speaking through someone, they're going to lie. Okay? Demons, like men, have free wills. Okay? So you can't force them to tell you the truth. So stop even doing that. I don't even know why people get involved in that, but they do. We have the Holy Ghost. Who needs demons, right? So anyway, another thing is God's a jealous God. Look to Him. Don't be looking to get your questions answered from the enemy, all right? Talking to demons, another thing is talking to demons discourages us. It discourages us from waiting on God and allowing the gifts of the Spirit to manifest. You know, that's what you need. to get people delivered is the gifts of the Spirit. You need wisdom from God, a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, so on. So do it that way. You saw Jesus, how he handled demons over and over. He just made them shut up and come out, basically. The only time I ever saw in the New Testament where Jesus talked to a demon and asked a question was, "What's your name?" And the second he found out about what the situation was there, he dislodged them, even though they did ask him something. And he asked them to go into the pigs, and he cast them out. That's all. I mean, he made them shut up. He made them come out. And that's what you need to do. Always think in those terms. Make them shut up. Make them come out. And if they're having a hard time, find out why. And you do that through two ways. Number one, you go to God, you go to the Holy Spirit, ask him for wisdom. Secondarily, you talk to the individual. Because maybe that's something there that needs to happen. As an example, somebody may have not forgiven somebody or this thing or that thing. And they need to do that. When they do that, that particular evil spirit or whatever you're dealing with will come out very easily. So, when you rely upon information coming from demons, you give them control. They'll literally start controlling deliverance sessions. You don't want to do that. Now, and again, Scripture forbids us to do this. This activity is no different than New Age or cult activity, and Christian deliverance ministries are participating in this, even as I'm speaking to you right now. So if you're listening to me, quit it. If you're doing that, repent, get that right. Don't ever do it again. Don't hang around people who do that. One lady sent me a nice email saying that she was involved in a deliverance online group, which I don't know about some of this. But anyway, she said that they were teaching this, and they were taught about this, getting information from demons stuff. And then so she's heard one of my videos where I was discouraging that activity, and she sent it to this guy who was doing that, and to his credit, he repented and got right on it and stopped doing it, at least last I heard. So that's good. So this is why we're doing this, is if you can't find Scripture, all you have to do to learn about deliverance really is to go to every Scripture in the Bible were concerned deliverance, and maybe we'll do that sometime, and go through them and carefully meditate on what's being said there and how it's done, and you'll begin to see the same principles used over and over and over and over again, and you'll see that they're basically the same things, sometimes a little bit different. Maybe the Word of God is used, maybe the anointing destroys the yoke, maybe the Bible says that the power of God goes into somebody and sets them free from evil spirits. Sometimes they're cast out. Sometimes it's simply the word that comes forth, cast them. There's a lot of different ways, but they're all biblical. And so keep coming back to that, because those are the things that God has given us, the weapons that he gives us, the blood of Jesus, the word of God, the name of Jesus, these things. Requiring a demon to speak something through someone isn't edifying. And except in the case where you might ask them what their name is if you had to, like I talked about, which I do very rarely. I don't even go there unless I have to. That's just not edifying for the person, okay? And so you want to try to keep it as edifying and as easy to do as possible. Flee pride. Some folks who talk about this, talking to demon stuff, they get all puffed up in pride because they think they know more than everybody. They talk about all this stuff the demon said and the way the kingdom of darkness works, and they've got all this stuff, and they got charts and everything else they made out of this. And if you try to correct them, they're prideful. They're arrogant. These type of folks really don't have any kind of real deliverance ministry, and they're going to get in trouble. Use the gifts of the Spirit that God gives us. That's what you need. Okay. I'll be honest about it. I've heard of more than one deliverance ministry who participated in getting information from demons that got into faulty information, faulty doctrine, doctrines of demons, got deceived and got into strong deception, doctrinally got into error, and actually loose living and managed to destroy their life and ministry. So you don't want to get information from demons because doctrines of demons are powerful. If that's not the case, then why are most of our young people in college campuses today so goofed up in their thinking? Because they're being preached and taught in our college and high school campuses and stuff, doctrines of demons. And doctrines of demons have power to deceive. That's the Bible says stay away from that kind of stuff. So you shouldn't be doing that, okay? The occult, secret hidden mysteries is what the occult means, really. They get their information and revelation from demon spirits. That's how the cults got started. That's how cults get started. A false vision or a dream or a false angelic appearance. So you don't want to just go over there and start doing that because you think it's somehow going to give you information. Don't do that. I've seen thousands of people now delivered without conversing with that demon whatsoever, and you could too. It should too. Another thing is speaking with demons, really just all that kind of stuff, delays the reason you're there, which is to get somebody delivered. Now, let me tell you something. I understand there's a temptation to do it because I've been, you know, when I was early on doing this, it's tempting to want to do these things, but I'm telling you right now that they're not edifying. They won't help anybody. They won't help you, and you can get into trouble. So just bypass that. It's mostly young, inexperienced ministers who are trying to do this, especially over the internet, who fall into this. They don't have any accountability. They've never been taught right. And they're the people who do this kind of stuff most of the time. I've seen it over the years. So I would always read books by people who've been doing that, this particular ministry for a long time, who are older, seasoned, have been through all of the stuff that the younger ones haven't got through yet. It really, really is not the easiest thing to do at times, nor is it, nor should it be something that we just, you know, think everybody should get involved in. Now, I'm not saying Christians have authority. We got authority over the devil. But we just need to have some guidelines, is what I'm saying. So keep watching my videos. You know, quote the Word of God. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, but the Word of God, not what demons say. What demons say have no relevancy in our lives. I don't really care what they think or say, and it really matters very little. Until next time, I hope you enjoyed that. Listen, we're running out of time. You can go to our website, faithalivefellowship.org. And then you can jump over to other website, our other YouTube pages and stuff, Twitter and so on. And you can become a partner with us over there. People are becoming partners with us. You can sow into the ministry if we've been a blessing to you. If this has been a blessing to you, now listen very carefully here, because if this message has been a blessing to you and you saw some things from it, oh boy, you know, I see somebody or know somebody who's getting involved in some of this, you might want to do them a favor. I don't know if they'll listen to this, but you could send it to them and just say, you know, this really helped me out. This guy knows what he's talking about. He's been doing it for so many years. And his videos, you can be sure that he's on the scriptures. And if you'll do that, you might be able to help some people, especially those who are interested in deliverance and want to help people. Because there's a lot of good people out there. And I started off this session by reading the scripture that we are to share with other faithful people what we've learned, and so they can teach others. Well, that's what this is all about. This deliverance message is number 12 or 13, I think 12. Yeah, so there's 12 of them that we've done, either a half an hour or more. A lot of information, and we'll do more. You can get a lot of information. Just go back to number one, start there, start going through them. There's good training there for you, and you won't get into trouble. Until next time, we love you. If you do write us, always remember this. Include your prayer requests, and we'll be happy to pray for you. And feed your faith. Starve your doubts to death. God bless you.